The world is about to end. My phone tells me so all the time. A constant stream of bad news. So much bad news so constantly that it's hard to work out how serious a threat everything is. I've completely lost perspective.
The threat of climate change, the rise of the machine, food shortages, epidemic disease, Fatberg sentience.
I was just asking if you wanted a cup of tea.
And I don't change my behavior. I still fly to like Edinburgh because it's cheaper than getting the train for some reason. And I still forget to take my bag for life to the supermarket, even though I've got about 10 of them gathering dust here. It's quite a collection I got building up. Even if I've got my backpack on, I'll still be like, no, give me another plastic bag. I think my backpack's full. Well, it's not full, but it's got my laptop in there. I don't want to be putting cottage cheese next to it.
I began to feel like I was losing the plot. We're closer to the end every day and nobody has any answers. My friends and I just compete to be the most pessimistic without ever trying to consider any solutions.
I heard the Arctic's gonna be completely ice-free by the end of the century.
I heard mid-century.
I heard within 20 years.
Anyone want another hoppy beer?
Absolutely, mate.
I had to do something about it.
I mean, I'm miserable. What is the point of going to my friend's birthday party or going out for dinner or washing my body when the world's just gonna end? It's all doomed.
Liam Williams, I diagnose you.
And those for judges.
With being a moody, pessimistic bastard.
What sort of diagnosis is that?
Your prescription? To stop doom-mongering and make an active investigation into the most serious threats to human civilization.
So when has that been available on the NHR? That made-up doctor was right. I do need to stop worrying about the world's problems and try to find some solutions.
I decided to make a fresh start. I locked my phone away and ate my SIM card.
So, in this show, I'll walk and talk to this camera around an anonymous British city and try to educate myself and give us all some optimism about the threats facing society. This week, we look at the issue of climate change. Hey, it's a lovely summer's day. Let's go outside.
97% of climate scientists agree that our warming climate is due to human activity. That's a lot. If 97% of my friends thought I was a dickhead, I would feel strongly that action was necessary. But they don't. Having eaten my SIM card, I couldn't go online, so I went to my local library to do some more research. But it had been closed down. So I next went to another cathedral of knowledge, where I knew I'd be welcomed. The science department of the local university.
You can't go through, I'm sorry.
Why?
Because you need a special pass to go in.
I'm a student.
We do need a copy of your passport.
Not of the university, I'm a student of life.
And we need proof of address.
There's no time for this.
This is the way it is, you know?
I could ring my mum and she can tell you who I am. It would be easier maybe
understand.
If I could just cut
we have to go through the proper procedures.
The procedures.
In the end, I had to make do with a free scientific journal that I found in the reception area. It was quite niche.
It says in here that climate change could disrupt our seasons and natural cycles. For example, daffodils are flowering earlier and earlier, and as warming increases, they'll flower earlier still. What a head fuck. It'll undermine our entire delicate folk culture, so dependent on ancient natural traditions. The daffodils flowering earlier and earlier, maybe flowering as early as Christmas Day. That'll totally undermine Christmas. We'll have to sing the holly and the ivy and the daffodils now as well, weirdly. It'll be a terrible carol. And then the daffodils flowering earlier still, maybe flowering on bonfire night or getting trampled by people on their way to fireworks displays. And then the daffodils flowering earlier, flowering on Halloween, and that'll be shit because they'll be appropriated as a kind of horror symbol, people drawing little fangs on the coronas of the daffodils, they'll go the way of the friendly pumpkin. And then the daffodils flowering earlier still, maybe flowering earlier in the autumn, and then flowering in the summer, and then flowering in the spring again. And we'll be like, oh good, it's gone back to normal. And the scientists will say, no, those are next year's daffodils, come early.
Why will nobody listen? Why aren't we caring about this?
Climate science can be very confusing as well as scary. Maybe that's why the public finds it a very difficult subject to think about and would rather talk about anything else. How do you feel about climate change?
feels like you're just putting water on your face, but then you look amazing.
What do you think about rising sea temperatures?
I think Messi's doing it again, so yeah, in Barcelona this year.
Did you know that by 2040, swathes of Europe will be desert and there will be great lakes in London?
On the Friday, I might put an egg on it.
Who can blame them, given our media? Why is it that weather forecasters don't tell us the truth about the increasingly strange weather?
Elsewhere, deserts are really spreading quickly across Europe, so watch out for those if you're taking a mini break this weekend. And there's a real outside chance of war breaking out absolutely anywhere at any time. Really scary stuff. And of course, I wouldn't rule out crocodiles breeding in the Arctic Circle either. It certainly is looking a bit Ragnarok-y. And now the sport. Oh, sorry, I'm just hearing that all the sport has been postponed due to snow and or wildfires.
Why isn't climate chaos in the news more? I always used to think it was because of powerful climate change deniers, but then I realised that they're such a minority that it's surely very unlikely that they'd really ever be in positions of power. Maybe the problem is not individuals, but institutions. That's why I've come here to the HQ of a major oil company to take direct action in the form of legal protest. Oi! Close down. Close yourself down. Stop your monopolies. System change, not climate change.
By the end of the day, the oil company was still operating. And in fact, their share price had gone up 0.2%. The security guard didn't even seem to care I was there. All seemed hopeless, and I couldn't help fearing for any future grandchildren I might have, such as this one.
Grandad?
Yeah?
Why did you and your generation forsake us in this way?
Me? And my generation? What could we have done any differently?
Well, you could have protested.
I did protest. I threw water at a building, and did it do any good? No.
Well, you could have been more inventive. You could have occupied an oil rig or something.
You need skills to do stuff like that, and bravery, and expensive waterproof clothing. I didn't have any of those things. And in the early 21st century, all popular protests became completely ineffective in the face of unaccountable corporate power. Don't they teach you anything in history at school?
I don't go to school because of the floods and the weird gases and the snakes.
Yeah. Well, I did what I could.
But surely you could have done something more useful than sitting on your backside, drinking beer and letting your whole life be a waste.
Fuck you, grandchild.
Well, I haven't found any cause for optimism, but maybe that's okay. As the inspiring 16-year-old activist Greta Thunberg recently said, I don't want your hope. I want you to panic so that you act. I didn't find any solutions. But I can't go back to my state of apathy either. So there's only one thing for it. Panic.